I sat by that hospital bed, you were worthy, and she could barely lift her head. You were worthy. After all those tears were shed,
let powerful ways in the lives of his people and our personal stories, our testimonies. They're powerful. They stir our hearts to worship because we see the evidence of God doing only what he can do. And throughout scripture, we see what happens when people experience the hand of the Lord in their lives. And then there's a really cool thing that happens too, that you see what happens to the people around them when they share the thing that God has done in their lives. So at Harvest, we want to continue to share the evidence of God at work in the lives of the people here. So the unexpected seasons, the failures and trials, the highs and lows of life, we see the faithfulness of God through it all. And whether you guys have been here for a while or you're new, once a month we show a God at Work video. And so that's just what we're going to do right now. Go ahead and have a seat. And as we turn our attention to the screens, we want to continuously show the faithfulness of God at work in the lives of his people here in our church.
I'm Eric Peterman.
And I'm Britta Peterman, and we attend the Rolling Meadows campus. I grew up in a Christian home, and so faith for me was something that was just embedded in my life. But it really wasn't until I was in college that I began to have a relationship with the Lord.
I grew up in a Christian home as well. I played sports through high school and into college, and I got connected with Fellowship of Christian Athletes. That's really where my faith, I think, became my own.
Eric and I both were athletes, and so it's actually where we met, was in FCA.
After I had graduated from college, I played football professionally for a couple years with the Chicago Bears.
After grad school and living in the city for a couple years, we got married and we started off in wedded bliss. Our firstborn, Elijah Ted Peterman, was born March 17th, 2016. His first few months of life were a whirlwind.
I was extremely excited to have a boy so that I could coach his football team, and everything was going great.
Was at our four-month appointment with him, just a normal kind of routine follow checkup, that our pediatrician just started getting a little worried. He was not really meeting some of his growth milestones. They wanted to intentionally hospitalize to run some tests on him. Eric and I were planners, we're doers. We're kind of like, okay, let's just check this off the list and we'll kind of get on with our little family. What was supposed to be one overnight stay turned into a couple nights. They started finding some things in blood work. He was having seizures. He had seizures for 3 days in the hospital. He lost his vision. He lost the ability to eat, and he lost all of his muscle control after the seizures. They led us to go get genetic testing.
I remember sitting in the geneticist's office, getting the results back, saying that a gene mutation from Britta and a gene mutation from Eric happened to get together and produce muscular dystrophy for our son. It's literally one in 100 million or more of chances that this would happen.
His type was so rare, but something that should affect his limbs. But Eli's was affecting his brain. His brain was actually shrinking over the years.
Our future that we thought we had with an athletic, healthy kid, it was just rocked.
As Eli's life progressed, it became more and more difficult. There was more treatments, more and more surgeries, medications. 2020 brought its own challenges, and so we were in the hospital when the world shut down. Our doctors looked at us every day and said, we have to get you home. They knew the hospital was about to be at capacity. They didn't want us there anymore, but we didn't have a way to get home. There was no way to control his pain without a special medication that could only be given at the hospital.
He just cried nonstop. And I'll never forget just holding him in my arms and just breaking my heart because there's nothing I could do to stop his pain. Just thinking, like, God, why? Like, help, help.
It felt really hopeless. We didn't have an end in sight. We began attending Harvest right before Eli was born, and we were placed in the most amazing and purposeful small group. The community of people the Lord put in our life really kind of carried us through a lot of our years with Eli. We'd come home to a freezer stocked of food, my pantry cleaned out and organized. Their prayer and their willingness to continue to show up and help us, that really kind of helped carry us through. As we continued to pray and use our community, the Lord provided an answer, and it kind of came to our hospital staff one day to enter Eli into hospice care.
Most people think about hospice when your grandma or grandpa are end of life, and to put a 3-year-old into hospice was not something I ever thought I'd have to do.
as the weeks kind of went on while we were at home, we saw some really good days. We saw some smiles again. But then he started to show us some signs. His lungs were shutting down and his body just began to shut down. I will never forget, even in that moment, you know, when the hospice staff are sitting and kind of telling us this, my first instinct, of course, is to fix. It's to take control of the situation. Well, the nurses had gotten to know us pretty well. They knew our faith. They knew our story. And they just said, and when the Lord's calling him home, it's time to go. Something you never want to have to do for your own kids. But after the years that we got with Eli, we knew when the Lord was ready for him, we wanted Eli to be able to run into those arms. It was 2020. The world was shut down. We couldn't do a funeral. We couldn't do a normal goodbye. We were thankful for Harvest that they allowed us to do a small funeral of just our family. We were able to bury Eli just a few blocks from our home. So it's a place that we still get to go and see him. It's now been 2 years since Eli has passed. We've started to do a lot of processing and healing through that and trying to figure out all, you know, the whirlwind that the Lord was teaching and doing in our lives through all of that. And the Lord was really teaching us, I think, through Eli's life to surrender, that the control piece is not ours. It was the Lord's. He had a plan and he had a hand in it all. And if we let it go and we surrendered, we put it at the foot of the Lord, that's where we felt like the peace and joy. Since Eli's passed, we welcomed another beautiful daughter, Jenna Joy. We're super thankful and blessed to have another daughter, another healthy daughter. And just keeping up with the two of them is keeping us pretty busy the last year.
Elijah never spoke a word in his life. He never spoke the gospel to anybody. But through the life that God gave him and the 4 years that God gave him on this earth, he's touched so many people. He's showed God to so many people. We've run marathons for muscular dystrophy to raise support. We've spoken Elijah's story to WGN News.
Every year in April, we have an Honor Eli Day, and it's a day where we ask people to share what makes them brave, what brings them joy, or to spread some joy or bravery to other people.
It's an opportunity for us to give back to others that are experiencing some of the pain, but also an opportunity to talk about Eli's story and to point that back to God.
I think it's still a journey that we're on. I don't think the Lord's anywhere near done with us yet, but we know that the Lord gave us a story. The Lord gave us Eli. We were so blessed and lucky to be his parents. Our goal for the rest of our life is for sure to sing the Lord's praises through him.
Share our stories because we have it together, but we share the stories because we all are just so in need of you. And so as we come in with need, we just ask for more of you in our lives. We know that you see each one of us. Thank you. Thank you that you're the God who sees. you're the God who takes us by the hand and walks with us. Thank you that you're a God who doesn't leave a single stone unturned in our lives. And so, God, as we continue and we worship you, we worship you knowing that, Lord, we're so desperate for you. We need your hand, a touch of you in our lives.
God, I look to you. I'm all. walk with him for all eternity. There will be a day when all bow for him. There will be a day when death will be no more. Standing face to face with his dying rose again. Holy, holy is the
resurrection, the hope we have in Christ. Amen. Let's give it up for our worship team. Well, good morning, Harvest. It's so good to see you all this morning. My name is Stephanie Olford. I'm the Central Women's Director here at Harvest Bible Chapel, and we're so glad you decided to join us today. If this is your first time, special welcome to you. So glad you decided to check it out. We would love to connect with you guys in the lobby over by the Connect Room after service. Also, if you are in junior high, you are dismissed to go to the Cornerstone to enjoy your service. If you don't know about this, we actually have a service for junior high right now, so go check it out. Awesome. See you guys. Well, this is for first-time guests and for people who've been here for a while. It's time to check in. Check in. So pull out your phone and you can check in and check in your family. And then also you can get sermon notes and also be able to put in prayer requests. So that's an awesome opportunity. Oh, you guys can sit down. I'm so sorry. I just start talking and then I'm like, hey guys, this is so great to see everyone. Awesome. Well, also on the screen, you're gonna see ways to give. So part of our worship is we wanna give our offerings to the Lord, give financially to him and give the best of what we have to him. And so there's several ways to give. You can give online, you can give through text, mobile app, and also mail. We also have some blue boxes in the back of the room if you have a check or cash with you as well. 2 Corinthians 9:7 says, each must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. This is an act of worship. This is us being able to honor the Lord with what he's given us. Everything we have is not ours. Everything we have is a gift, our finances, our abilities, and this is an opportunity to give back to the Lord. So awesome. Another fun thing that we have coming up is how to study the Bible. That starts this Wednesday, August 17th at 7 p.m. at Rolling Meadows. You can register online at harvestbiblechapel.org. This is an awesome opportunity to get to learn how do I study the Word and also how do I teach the Word? How do I explain it to people? So it's going to be really, really cool. Jeff Bucknam is going to be teaching, Kyle Meeker, Kim Barco, and myself. I really hope you guys will take advantage of this opportunity. Also coming up, we have our next Seek Night. Vanessa, can you tell us a little bit more about Seek Night and what's been happening at these nights?
Okay, here we go. Okay. Hey everyone. It's fun to actually be able to just talk and do an announcement instead of always sing. So we've been doing Seek Nights here throughout the summer, and what these Seek Nights are, it comes from Matthew 7, verse 7, and it says, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks the door will be opened. And we have started the Seek Nights to create space for just that, to be able to come before the Lord in his presence and to be able to ask him to seek more of his presence. And even just to be praying for our city and our church. I mean, there's so many things. I know I said it earlier that we come in here into this space and we bring in so much, but then there's also so much going around in our city and the world. And so we wanted to create a space to come and seek more of the Lord, to ask him and to bring before him our needs, and really just to get a greater glimpse of him. And so that's happening Thursday, August 25th, right here. Thanks.
7 p.m., so awesome. You guys will want to check that out. Also, part of our service is we want to pray for another Bible-believing church, and we're going to pray today for City Line Bible Church and Pastor Mo Zachariah. And we love him, and we are so excited about what he is doing over at City Line. So we're going to pray for him and pray for our service today. Heavenly Father, you are so good. And Lord, we praise you for who you are. We just draw our attention to you and what you're doing. And God, you are holy and worthy of praise. Lord, we lift up Pastor Mo and City Line Bible Church to you. God, I pray that you be with their service this morning. Be with them as they prepare for the new year, a new ministry year. That God, you would just bring fresh growth and fresh vision to their church. Lord, I pray for Pastor Jeff as he is preaching, that, Lord, you just be with him, that, Lord, you would be able to anoint him and fill him afresh as he brings your word, that, God, you would open our hearts to what you have to teach us this morning. That's not JT's words, but it's your words, Lord. And, Lord, we just ask that you would just move in our service this morning. We love you, and we're thankful for you. As we bring our attention to God's word, open your Bibles to Psalm 133.
Hey, Harvest. It is so great to be with you this day and to look into God's Word. And, you know, before we jump right into Psalm 133, you know, this is a pretty exciting time of year where a lot of schools are starting. You know, we have a Christian school, HCA, out on our Elgin campus. They're starting this week. My kids go to back to school in the city in a couple weeks. We start kind of late. But I'd like to take a few moments just as we're getting into this season and before we get started in God's Word to just spend some time praying for our schools and for our students. So I want to do something a little weird. If you're a student of any age, I would love for you to just stand up on all of our campuses. Also, if you're a teacher or if you're a school administrator, I would love for you to stand and we're going to pray as a church family together for you and for the year ahead. So let's join together as brothers and sisters in Christ and pray over these dear ones who are headed into this school year. Father, we are grateful for the opportunity that we have to learn and to grow our minds and to grow our hearts, to follow after you in deeper ways. God, we thank you for so many teachers and administrators who are standing across all of our campuses and the ways that they continue to give of themselves and serve as Christ has served the church. To serve people, to serve these students, to give of themselves. God, would you give them strength? Would you give them wisdom? Would you give them endurance for the year ahead? And God, we would pray that you would do a mighty work in them and through them. And Father, for each of the students standing on all of our campuses, God, we pray that you would be with them this year, enable it to be a year of incredible growth for them. Growth educationally, but also growth socially, and most importantly, growth in you, that they would deepen their walk with you in the year ahead. God, we would pray for protection over all of our students, over each of the schools that they represent. God, would you be overseeing all of that? We know that you hold it all in your hands, that nothing is too difficult for you. So would you protect them in the year ahead? Protect them physically, protect them from many of the worldly ideas that may be coming in at times. God, in all things, would you be glorified in our lives, in our schools, and in our students, in our teachers and leaders this year, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much. You can be seated. We will continue to pray for each of our students this year, trusting the Lord that it will be a great year of growth for each of them. All right, now grab hold of your Bible, turn to Psalm 133. We're continuing in our series, Ascent, on the Psalms of Ascent. This is one of my favorite sections. I feel like I say that about a lot of God's Word, but this really is one of my favorite sections of God's Word, the Psalms of Ascent, these songs and poems that were said and sung to one another. Now, I'm not that great of a singer. They don't let me lead worship around here, but I have really found that in my growth, in my walk with the Lord, that songs have deepened my affections for the Lord. And perhaps in the last few years, more than anything else, even more than God's Word, singing songs of praise and worship to the Lord has deepened my faith in incredible ways that I would not have seen. Because songs stir our affections. For almost everyone as well, we're more likely to remember a song than we are even a Bible verse. Songs can help us remember truths of God's Word. When I was in college, this is over 20 years ago, there was a professor who would begin many of the classes by singing little scripture memory songs, these little catchy tunes that were where you're singing God's Word, and he would make all of his students do this. And to this day, more than 20 years later, I still remember, like a gold ring in a pig's snout is a beautiful woman who lacks discretion, Proverbs 11, 22. See, I told you, they don't let me lead worship around here. But the amazing thing about that is I never had that professor. I never took a single class from him. But just being in the dorms and being on campus and other students singing that song, it's still in my head more than 20 years later. Because songs help us remember and songs stir our affections. These psalms, that's what they're meant to do. They're meant to help us remember the truths of God's word and to help us stir our affections for a perfect Heavenly Father and all that He calls us to do. So because they won't let me lead worship normally, I'm going to do it anyway right now. No, what I would like for us to do is read this psalm together aloud. Because these were meant to be sung and said in a community of believers, let's all read this together as we get into God's word. Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head, running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. You guys did great. Maybe they'll let me lead worship after all. But this is a simple, a short psalm of blessing. And it's a psalm about the unity of the people of God. It's teaching us that when we as followers of Jesus Christ live in unity with one another, we live out a blessing of holiness and of refreshment. Look at verse 1 again. He says, behold how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. Here, this word brothers, what we see here, this really is brothers and sisters. What this is talking about, it's not just talking about dudes. And it's not talking about physical brothers. It's talking about members of a faith community. It's figuratively in reference to close friends who are members of a spiritual community. So it's talking about us. It's talking to those of us who've turned from our sins and trusted Jesus Christ by faith. And now we're a part of a family together. We're in this together. We're brothers and sisters. And there's incredible blessing for those who dwell in unity. Now again, these Psalms of Ascent, they were said and sung during the three pilgrimages every single year. The people of God every year were supposed to take these three times, and wherever they were from in the area, they were to come together in Jerusalem. And as they would walk up the mountain, they would sing and say these songs together. They came from different areas. They came from different tribes. They came from different ways of life and different jobs and different financial statuses. And yet, they all came together for the one purpose of worshiping the Lord together. And each week we get that same privilege. We come from different backgrounds, sometimes different languages or nationalities. We come from different financial statuses, different locations, even different campuses, from Crystal Lake to Meadows, from the North Shore to Aurora and Elgin and Chicago. And we all come from different places, and we all are different. But we come together to dwell in unity and to worship the Lord. There's incredible unity in that. And we do celebrate the fact that we are all different and God has not made a whole bunch of JTs. I'm really grateful for that, trust me. That we're all different. That God's given us different gifts and abilities and strengths and ways that we can care for each other. But the incredible thing is that we all have a perfect Savior who's taken us from death to life. We've been redeemed. We've been set free. We've been given a place in a family of unity to worship the Lord. And we're told that it's good and it's pleasant. It's a joy and it brings pleasure for us. Now, I think we have all experienced some relationships that are easy and they just seem effortless, where we seem to just have a good time right away, right when we get together. We sort of understand the person. We're able to communicate easy without strife or frustration, and we can really be ourselves around those people. It's an incredible blessing that we could let our guard down and be who we really are without fear of rejection or strife or betrayal. It's good and pleasant when we live like that. But I think most of us have also experienced relationships that aren't so good and aren't so pleasant, where they take a little bit more work, where you feel like you're walking on eggshells, where you feel like every conversation I have, I gotta weigh the word choice and my tone of voice and how I'm gonna say that and where I look and all of those, because they might take it the wrong way. Let me just tell you, that is exhausting. If you've lived in a relationship, had a friend like that, where you've tried to work on some things, it's a lot of work just to have a simple conversation. And what we're seeing is this reality that we see in the text. It's draining to have strife with a person, but it's good and pleasant to have unity with one another, to dwell in unity. It's this idea of sitting down, of remaining. It's a continual, ongoing, enduring communion with one another. And this is a charge for all of us to have that kind of unity, being at peace and being together in mutual respect for one another with the purpose of God's mission. It's not being identical. It's truthfully not even agreeing on everything, but it's being together and being at peace with mutual respect for one another for the purpose of God's mission. It's not just headed the same direction. It's headed there together. The other day, just earlier this week, I was doing a wedding rehearsal for a couple, and I only know the couple. I didn't know anyone else there. And I walk into this hotel in the city, and kind of, you know, it's a busy hotel with all sorts of people around. And I kind of make my way through the lobby there, and this guy starts walking up next to me, and it's kind of, okay, you know. And so we walk up to the elevator, and I hit the button, and we stand there for a minute, and the elevator door opens, and we get on, and I hit 4, because that's where I'm going. I said, where are you going? He says, 4. I'm like, okay, great. You know, we're standing in the elevator. Sitting there for a minute. The door's open. He's very kind and, like, holds the door for me, you know, does that thing. So I'm like, oh, thanks. And I get out and walk. I go left, and he kind of, like, follows me, like, right behind me, and I'm kind of like, okay. And we go down this hall, kind of weaving a little bit. We finally get to this ballroom where the wedding is going to be, and I go to reach for the door just as he's reaching for the same door. And I'm like, oh, you're going to the rehearsal too? You know? But it was a little awkward, just truthfully. I kind of laughed about it, like, oh, sorry, I didn't really, you know, that kind of thing. But, like, we went to the same place, but we weren't really going there together. And it was just kind of awkward. And how different is that than going out on a walk through a forest preserve with your spouse? You see, in both instances, you're headed in the same direction. You're headed to the same place. But one of them, you're headed together, and one of them is just a little awkward. And this is talking about headed there together, dwelling in unity together. Now, obviously, our unity together, our community, is not always a nice walk through a forest preserve. Community can be difficult, it can be painful, and it does take work. Just like a relationship with a sibling that you feel like, you know, we're kind of at each other's head. Does anyone have a sibling who can be a bit of a pain? A few of you do, and the rest of you are the sibling who's a pain, which is okay. There's grace for that too. So was I. But there's some work that you have to do in your family to kind of, like, you know, your kids, you're just fighting over every little thing. But then you kind of grow through that, and you have mutual respect for one another. And on the other side of all of that, there's unity there. We're told in Hebrews 12 to strive for peace with everyone. That it should take work. Not every relationship is effortless. We are to work for this unity so that we can dwell in unity together. Here's the command from God's word. This is Philippians 2. It says, do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit. You good there? That's easy, right? Okay, do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Well, that's easy, right? Count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. That's our model as we strive for unity together, as we strive for peace with all people. And even though it's work and it can be uncomfortable at times, it's good and it's pleasant when we achieve that unity together. And so we're to work for it. Can I just get a little practical with you right now? So who's that person that came to your mind when I talked about a difficult relationship? That person when you're like, yeah, there's some strife there. Yeah, every time I talk to her, it's just, oh man, so difficult. Who's that person that you feel like we can't seem to always get along? It's a lot of work for that person. Who's the person who you don't have unity with right now? Because scripture would tell us that if you're not right with a brother or sister, you're to leave your offering and go make it right with that person. That's how we strive for peace with everyone. But you don't understand what they have done in the past. I mean, he hasn't even owned up to all of the stuff that he's done wrong. She hurt me over and over, and then every time we get together, it's like we're butting heads. Scripture says, Romans 12, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with everyone. Live peaceably with all. Our job isn't to correct every person. Our job isn't to fix everything or point out everything that they've done wrong or stick their nose in it or even wait for an apology. Our job is to seek peace with everyone as much as possible. Listen, I tell my kids all the time when I was preparing this sermon, they're like, oh no, we're going to be in the sermon, aren't we? So I'm not going to give any specific examples because I love my kids. But when they do fight, what I tell them all the time is, I don't care who started it. I don't care whose fault it is. I don't care about either side. I do care that you get along. I do care that you love one another. I do care that you respect each other. If you're fighting all the time, you've already lost. So seek unity together. Strive for peace with everyone. Because that unity is a blessing to us. It's good and it's pleasant and it can be a source of great joy for us. And what follows here in the text is are two similes about what this unity is like. So let's go back to Psalm 133. He says, behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head, running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robes. He's saying it's like that. This unity is like that. It's a blessing to us, but unity leads to holiness. So the simile here, what they're saying is it's like this oil that's poured out on Aaron's head. And I thought for a minute, so when I grow a beard, I get like super itchy down here. I don't know if any other guys do, but you put that like beard oil on it, like super helps. So that's what I first thought when I read this. But that's not what it's talking about at all. It's not talking about relief. Instead, what it's talking about is consecration. It's talking about holiness. It's talking about being set apart for a specific purpose and plan of the Lord. So Aaron was the very first high priest. And in Exodus 29, he and his sons are anointed with oil. And throughout the nation of Israel, throughout their history, every time there was a high priest, this is what would happen. The nation would come together and they would anoint that person as the high priest, symbolizing God's presence, symbolizing holiness and set apartness for that person. That oil was a symbol that the person was set apart and holy to the Lord. The oil that they would use was like a really specific recipe that they were told how to use. They were told not to imitate it, not to use it for anything other than the worship of God. It was pretty strict in that way. And here you see twice that it's running down. It's, you see it flowing over his head and down his beard and onto his robe. It actually sounds very messy, doesn't it? How do you get that oil out of there and tied or something like that? But it's very meaningful to the people that it would be that much oil, that it would be flowing down to show just how set apart that person was to be. And this times when they would come together as a people and anoint a high priest, they would be both a national and a spiritual event for them. We don't have anything like this in our culture. It's way bigger than like the inauguration of a new president or even the ordination of a new pastor in a church or anything like that. Way bigger, because it was all of their, it was symbolizing all of their hopes, all of their trust in the Lord for the future. It was a symbol of God's presence among them and the fact that they as a people, we as a people, are set apart as holy to the Lord. It was a symbol of God's presence and all that he was going to do in hope for the future. What is God going to do in these next days, in these next years of our midst, in our time together? What is the Lord going to do? There was so much excitement going into all of that because it's a setting apart of a person and a people as holy to the Lord. But not just that individual as high priest, all of those who follow the Lord. What this psalm is telling us is that when we get together in unity, when we dwell in unity, we're displaying that holiness, that fact that we are set apart to follow the Lord and to be used by him. That there's a priesthood of all believers as we're consecrated for God's purposes. We're set apart for the worship of God and for the work of God. So when we get together, when we dwell in unity, we don't just do that for us. How can I be helped? How can I grow? How can I have a better week by Thursday? What can I get out of these things? That naturally happens. We do grow through our time together, but that's not the end goal. The end goal is that we as a people would be holy to the Lord, and that we would be used by him for his purposes. One of my other favorite verses, see, I told you, I have a lot of them, is Hebrews 10, 24 and 25, which says, "Let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, all the more as you see the day drawing near." See, our time together, we're to be considering, thinking about, what are the ways that I can stir up a brother or sister? What are the ways that I can help someone grow in their walk with the Lord? We're to stir them up, which is this idea of like shaking them to get them to wake up and let's go. I have a teenager now, and pretty much every day I got to walk into his room and like, come on, wake up, let's go, you know? It's waking the dead is basically what it is. But that's what I'm doing. I'm stirring him up to get ready for the day, to take the dog out, to do all of the things that he has to do to get ready for school and all of that. We're stirring one another up so that when we're getting together, when we're dwelling in unity, that's what we're to be doing in one another's life. Come on, let's follow the Lord in a greater way. Let's live our lives in ways that are set apart for him, in obedience, in love. And you see it here, one another to love and good works, that we're to be together to stir one another up to do those things, to love one another in greater ways, to love the Lord in greater ways, and to follow him in greater ways with our lives. And this can only happen when we're active in a community. Now, I know a lot of you guys, I mean, I can see it from here. A lot of you guys have your seats. This is like where I sit every Sunday. I can see mentally the cathedral right now, and I know where Elvin is sitting, and I know where Matt and Amanda Woodhead are sitting. I know we're people of habit. We do that. I sit in the same seat every Sunday too. I get it. But so lots of times we feel like, well, I sit here, and the guy over here, what is his name? I think I remember his name. I think it's George. I'm not totally sure. And we feel like we're in community. That's not community. You just happen to be sitting near people. You're not an act. That's not dwelling in unity. That's being in the same room together. So it takes a step to get into meaningful community with one another. If I can just put it bluntly, some of you need to join a small group this week. Some of you have been really, you know, busy. All sorts of things that have happened in our school and work and family and vacation and all these. And I haven't even been to small group in like 3 months. So you need to get back into community. Strive for peace. It takes effort to do that, but it's good and it's pleasant. It's time to get back to community. It's time to get back to this unity together. And this is a perfect time to do that. We've already talked about school starting. So many things are new. We've been praying and working a lot on continuing ways that we can sharpen and strengthen our group's ministry. And so much of that is happening like right now. We're beginning these things because we want to be a place that gathers together. And we want to be a place that grows together, and then we want to be a place that goes out on mission for Jesus Christ. And there is a place for you, and we want you to be a part of this community so that you can grow in this blessing, so that you can grow in holiness, so that you can grow in love and good deeds. We want to be a part of a community that stirs one another up to love and good deeds. So talk with somebody about it today. Send an email this week. Find somebody in the lobby. Get connected to a meaningful community of believers who will help you to grow in holiness and who you can help grow in holiness. Because God uses that community to deepen us, to bless us, to grow us. Unity brings holiness. And then unity brings refreshment. Let's go back to Psalm 133 one more time. It, the unity that we have together, it is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. Again, this is the second simile, and that is of refreshing dew that falls on the mountains. Now, Mount Hermon was much higher altitude than the rest of that region. It was a little more than 9,000 feet. And due to all the precipitation, Mount Hermon was known in the area as a place that was lush and green, even in the warm months. There was great refreshment for all of the vegetation there, even in the most dry of seasons. And that's the image here. That even during the driest and darkest seasons of your life, there can be great refreshment from the community of believers. When we dwell in unity together, Proverbs 17:17, a friend loves at all times, but a brother is born for adversity. A friend loves at all times, but a brother is born for adversity. One of the reasons you need to be in community is so that when difficult seasons come, and they are coming, you will have people around you who can bring godly refreshment to you. If you push everyone away and you isolate people, maybe out of fear, maybe out of busyness, whatever the reason, you are setting yourself up for failure. You're setting yourself up for loneliness during a dark time. And it's not just so that you can feel comfort during that. It's so that you can be holy during that time. So that God can use that time in your life to strengthen you. And if you are on your own, it's much more difficult to do that. No matter how difficult your pilgrimage is, no matter how difficult this very season of your life is, you can find incredible refreshment from the brotherhood of God's people. Romans 15:1 says, we who are strong, this is strong right now, it's not who's a strong person, we who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Listen, we have an obligation to it. If you're doing well in your walk with the Lord right now, you're not experiencing a massive trial and you're like, yeah, things are going pretty well, you have an obligation to care for those of us in this community who aren't doing great right now. And there are people all around you right now on every single campus that are going through the darkest season of their life. We have an obligation to care for one another. We're a family, and we're gonna dwell in unity together. So reach out to those who are struggling. I mean, way too often we don't know what to say, or what if they take it wrong, or I can't think of a verse right now, or I don't know what to do, or I don't have a plan, and so we don't do anything, and that's never helpful. Or we think I'm sure they have plenty of people around them. I mean, she's so popular. I'm sure she has like 100 friends who are already there for her during this. I'm sure he has people caring for some of those needs that I can see. Don't ever assume that. Always reach out. Listen, they might leave you on read there, but like, they will never get upset at you for sending them a text message that's encouraging. Hey, I don't really know what to say, but I can tell you're going through a difficult time. Let me know if there's anything I can do. I'm praying for you. That will never go poorly. Never. So always reach out. Far too often we take the, I don't know what to do, and then we don't do anything. That's a terrible place to be. So please reach out. Jesus left the 99 to go after one. We should do the same. And for some of you, you are in that dry season right now. You're longing for that dew from the mountains to fall down and bring a little bit of refreshment to you. Maybe it's a season of trial, or a season of doubting, or a season of waiting on the Lord to work. God, would you please answer this? And you're in that place of dryness, looking for some refreshment. Can I just say, just let somebody know. Raise your hand. Send a text message. Grab somebody in the lobby. Hey, I'm not doing great right now. Can we just grab a cup of coffee or something? Like, you got to let somebody know. And far too often, I've heard people say things like, well, I was going through X and nobody cared. Or I was going through this and everyone failed to do anything to help me, and I just was there on my own. In the gentlest way I know how to ask, who did you actually tell that then dropped the ball? Because I think a lot of times when we're in that dark place, we feel like no one cares. Most of the time, no one knows. Most of the time. And yes, we're broken and we fail and we drop the ball sometime, but I have found more often than not, no one was told. Yes, they should have kept watch. They should have reached out. They should have asked. We do have an obligation to care for others. But maybe they just missed it. Maybe it wasn't that they don't love you, but they just didn't really know what was going on. And even though people, godly people, can fail and drop the ball, and yes, should have done that. Yes, he should have done that. She should have. Yes, absolutely. I have found our church to be very willing to step in and love and do whatever is necessary when they know what is going on. So let's believe the best about one another. For those of you who are strong right now, be watching for the people who may need help and be asking those gentle, probing questions of people. And for those of us who are really struggling right now, let somebody know. There are people all around you that are willing to care and love and want to be there for you. Because those of us who are strong right now, it's not always going to be that way. You're going to hit a dry patch. It's coming. And those who are weak right now, let this be an encouragement. It's not lasting forever. There will be an end to that. And then you'll be in the position where you're the strong one seeking to help somebody who's going through a dry season. We need each other. We need to bring refreshment through our unity with one another. Our unity and our love for one another is the thing that is supposed to mark us as followers of Jesus Christ. This is a familiar verse to most of us. John 13:35, by this all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. The love that we have for each other, the dwelling in unity, is the thing that will mark us as followers of Jesus Christ. Life is to be enjoyed not just as an end in and of itself, but in communion with the people of God that brings goodness, that brings joy, that brings pleasure to us. And listen, it's not just getting through it. It's not just getting through life, but it's glorifying God with it. So if you're in that place of strength, it's using that for God's glory and for the good of the body of believers. And if you're in that difficult, dry spot, it's even using that for God's glory, because the Lord's working in you through it. And we can do this as a community together. Because being in community, being a follower of Christ and not being in community, it's a little bit like being a member of a family and then not wanting to have anything to do with them. Now, I know that there are some families that are a little difficult. I know that there's some challenges in families, and maybe you feel like you're in that spot. Maybe you feel like, some of my family is really weird. Listen, I am too, so it's okay. We're all a little bit weird. We're all broken, and that's why we need a perfect Savior, and that's why he's given us one another, because we're all a mess. We can't go around pretending that we have it all together. We're a mess, and we need each other, and God uses this community, this unity that we have together for our blessing. If you've trusted in Jesus Christ, you're a part of this community, messy as it can be. And we're super glad that you're here. And we may fail, we may even drop the ball at some times, but believe me when we say you are loved. Because we're a part of this family together, and we want to be building unity together. So the question isn't are you a part of the community, it's what type of part of this community are you? How are you going to live as a part of this community? Are you willing to step in, even when it might be hard or difficult or confusing, to do the work so that you can experience the blessing of dwelling in unity? Because when we as followers of Jesus live in unity with one another, we live out the blessing of holiness for the Lord and refreshment for one another. Let's pray. As we close, I'd like to pray Jesus' own words in the high priestly prayer. Jesus says, I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one even as we are one, I in them and you in me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and loved them even as you have loved me. Oh, Father, let this be true of us. Let us be a unified community of believers. Let us be one. even as you are one, Lord. Father, would you use us in one another's lives in meaningful and deep ways? We recognize each and every day how we are broken and fall short of your perfect standard, but we are grateful that you give us one another to call us to greater holiness, to greater obedience towards you, to greater love for you and a love for our sisters and brothers. God, would you transform us with that holiness, with that love? Would we see ourselves as set apart just for you? For your holiness, for your goodness, and for your purposes here on this world. Would you use us in one another's lives to bring about refreshment where needed? Be with the one who's strong right now to find the person around them who desperately needs encouragement or strengthening or peace or comfort. Would you give the wisdom, maybe when there aren't even any words to say, that just our presence would be enough, Lord? God, would you work through it? And for the one who is going through that dry and weary and dark season, would you bring refreshment from places that they wouldn't even imagine? God, would you surround them with believers who love them, who believe the best about them, who believe that you're working even in the midst of dark seasons? And we pray that you would encourage them and use them to be a refreshment in one another's lives. Oh God, we desperately want to be a community that loves you and loves others and is used by you to reach this world. So would you do it in our hearts? Would you do it in our lives? Would you do it in our community for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ? It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Death could die, you rose again and brought us life.
reminder that we need to live in unity with one another, and we are a part of a family. That's what we are, brothers and sisters in Christ. And so I just want to remind you guys, if you're not a part of a small group or not a part of a community, we would love to tell you more about that. So feel free to grab one of the staff members if you have a question about how to get plugged into a small group or what community could look like for you here at Harvest. If you need prayer, we're open up here to be able to pray with you guys. And as you go out on mission for the Lord, know that you are loved.